violence and Black Lives Matter protests in the name for Eric Garner and his family for justice around that point that happened in D.C. All that and more here on Waking Up, so stay tuned. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, King.
Good morning. How are you?
Good morning. It is 74 degrees, going up to 91 degrees today. The forecast keeps getting hotter and hotter, except for Thursday when it's supposed to rain and be 83. Tomorrow, 92. Thursday, 83. Friday, 91. 99 degrees on Saturday. So there's that. Let's get ready to fry those eggs out on the sidewalk, I guess. There's so much to discuss today. Most of the mainstream media is discussing the fact that President Trump has made those racist statements about people going back to their own country. A little bit later, I'm going to play a segment by one of our sister station hosts who is at Netroots Nation. Do you still have a conference high? You did something else since the conference, but I like to ride that conference high out. As long as it goes.
I'm still riding it. Plus, I'm gradually working my way through the swag bag, and I found some other great stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I didn't get one of those because I was late. I had to pick. I just grabbed stuff off.
I'll share.
Yeah, I have those This Machine Films Police thing. I think I have about 8 of them, so we can offer them as a gift. But anyway, I have from Egberto Willis from our sister station in Houston talks about why there's not going to be a race war, and talks about the importance of independent media and what we need to do to keep fighting these right-wing tropes. And let's talk about what's happening here, and then we'll talk about what you did yesterday. There is a march and rally for the 5-year anniversary of Eric Garner's murder. This is Wednesday at 6 p.m. at the Staten Island Ferry St. George Terminal, so the Staten Island Ferry side of that terminal. Participants in the action will be meeting there, and following a brief rally, there's going to be a march to the site of Eric's death to pay people's respects to the man who helped, whose murder helped ignite the Black Lives Matter movement. Now, King, yesterday you went down to what the Black Lives Matter movement is doing, because when you we brought in a Black Lives Matter activist who now has a show on this station, Shavona Newsom.
And Shavona and her team put together this bus ride down there to protest the fact that the statute of limitations is getting ready to run out on the prosecution of his case. And Eric Garner was killed on July 17th, 2014.
Tomorrow.
And the feds had until tomorrow to file these cases. And so they went down there to basically raise hell, and that's what they did.
We have some clips of the chanting that was going on down there. Let's get that in. And then we have some clips of folks. You spoke to some family members down there.
Mm-hmm.
Shut it down.
Justice for?
Eric Garner.
Say his name.
Eric Garner.
Justice for?
Eric Garner.
Say his name.
Eric Garner.
Justice for?
Eric Garner.
Say his name.
Eric Garner.
Justice for?
Eric Garner.
Say his name.
Eric Garner.
No justice.
Yeah, so
really, yeah, passionate, obviously
fired up,
good reason.
Went around the DOJ headquarters, made a few laps in the heat, went out into the street, blocked traffic for a while, got back out. So it was really
how many people
really
out
lively.
There?
I'd say about 50 to 70 people.
Now you said about that, a busload. That like BET was there, and there were other media outlets there.
Black Lives Matter NYC has really been shaking things up. They have a crew following them around for a reality show. How many times do you have to sign a media release in order to take part in a rally, though? I mean, usually. So this crew's been following around. They had CNN, they had Fox, local Fox. They had about 4 or 5 networks
covering
them. I hope
that's good. I still am slightly hesitant, but I hope that's good.
About which part?
Well, about when corporate media gets involved.
Well,
slightly.
I don't know
how I feel about BET, but CNN and Fox certainly don't have a stellar reputation for presenting stories.
Well, believe it or not, local Fox has a good reputation
a
for
better.
Covering things compared to national Fox. Yes.
Yeah.
And
why do they allow that? There's a question for some expert.
Trying to get the trying to get the eyes on the station. Right. You can't do that kind of stuff
dollar,
in New
dollar
York.
Bills right, for the right. ad agency.
You're not going to collect Benjamins in New York City, you know, slamming liberals and progressives all the time.
So, well, you were able to get an interview with another chokehold victim's wife. They're choking them all over the place, apparently.
Yeah, so
that's what we were saying before the show started. What's happening with all this choking?
So I got surprised. I got asked to say a few words, and I just mentioned that Eric Garner was chokehold 2.0 because so many of the people there were so young, they don't remember Anthony Baez, which we call chokehold 1.0. Mm. And the story that you're about to hear is a wife telling a story about what we call now chokehold 3.0 in New York.
Bringing you live to D.C.?
Okay, so tell me your name and why you're here today.
My name is Angelique McLoney-Kears. I am the wife of Andrew Kears, and I'm here in solidarity for Gwen and for Eric, as well as my husband, Andrew Kears.
And so what happened to him and when?
My husband, Andrew Kears, was murdered. He's murdered on May 11, 2017 by Schenectady Police Department. He just came home from doing a two-year bid and only lasted 15 days. And it's like me and the kids are still waiting for him. On that day,
It's okay.
Okay. On that day, he ran from police officers in America, in this KK America, really. You run, you stay, or you comply each and every time you die. So with that being said, like I said, he just came home from doing 2 years, and he ran. From when they apprehended him, they caught him behind the house. He stated that as soon as they got him, he said, "Ow, I'm hurt, my leg is broken," and he says, "I can't breathe." One of the officers states and says, "What do you want us to do?" Now my husband was 6'2", 270 pounds. It took three officers to place him in back of the police car where they apprehended him. They went around the block, and when he first initially ran, they took the car and they stood there. As he's in the police car, and you see this on the dash cam, it's a 45-minute dash cam. And when I mean, it's the most horrendous thing that you ever want to see.
What did you see?
You see him. Now, Andrew was, you know, tan color, light-skinned African-American. He went from tan to pale white. You literally see death in his face. He literally says to the officer, "I can't breathe." And the officer says, "Well, you shouldn't have ran then, Officer Mark Weeks." He says to the officer, "I feel like throwing up." The officer says, "Don't throw up in my car." He tells him, "I feel numb." He says, "Well, you shouldn't have ran then." Each and every time he's saying and begging, and he literally hear him saying, "I'm begging you, man, please." And at each and every time he's saying, and you hear him and he's going, and you hear him panting, and you hear him trying to fight it. And not one time did he get upset with the officer. Not one time did he curse out the officer. Because, you know, you're in that situation, you're in handcuffs. You're trying to tell him that you're losing your life. And he didn't hear him. He didn't see him. He didn't even stop.
And what did they say the cause of death was when they finally did the examination?
The cause of death was cardiac arrest, just like Eric Garner. He said, "I can't breathe 11 times, just like Eric Garner." And he had no indictments, just like Eric Garner. And this officer, Officer Mark Weeks, ended up getting a bus business that he just started in December from Schenectady, New York, all the way to New York City. So it's like a slap in our face.
Was he ever tried or punished or suspended or anything?
No, he took himself off the job. Excuse me, he took himself off the job, and as he took himself off the job, he ended up getting married. He ended up, as soon as he did his little, I think 3-4 months, he ended up going back on the job in this January. And no indictments, no nothing. He even told me after the Attorney General does his investigation that he will give me answers. I'm still waiting.
So there you heard it, and she sounds more composed. If you could have seen her, the way her face was contorting and the tears that were going down, and she told this story. And as you heard her in the beginning, she says, we and the children are still waiting for him to come home. Mm. So so that was one piece of the protest. And as everything began to wrap up and we got on the bus, we were on the way back, somebody found that the Washington Post had reported at 8 p.m. while we were riding up that the DOJ had decided to meet with Eric Garner's mother, his wife Esau, and mother of his children, and the lawyers, one day, that would be this morning at 10 a.m., one day before the deadline. So we're all going to be waiting to see what happens.
10 a.m.
And somebody from the bus, actually, Shivana's brother, read a text from Eric Garner's wife, thanking them for going down there, and it seemed to be her feeling that the fact that they were down there, got the media right in front of DOJ, might have contributed to the decision about this meeting.
I hope the meeting leads to some actual action.
Yeah.
I don't want any more thoughts and prayers, and I'm sure no one else
or does either. Or to have them go down there, as have happened with other families, to just go down there and get some bad news.
Yeah, and remember, so if you want to support this Wednesday, tomorrow, which is the anniversary of Eric Garner's murder, at the Staten Island Ferry St. George Terminal, you can go at 6 p.m. and participate in an action that's going to be kind of like it's going to be a rally, brief rally, but also a vigil, a march to the site of Eric's death to pay his respects to him, who his murder helped ignite the Black Lives Matter movement. You're listening to WBAI 99.5 FM in New York City. I'm Julianna Forlano in the studio with King Downing. The weather today in New York City is 75 degrees. Nope, 76 degrees, going up fast. It's going to be sunny all day long and 91 degrees. We've got, you know, a giant heat wave ahead, as they say, for the entire country. So we'll keep our eye on that. As I've said before, what they predicted yesterday isn't necessarily true for today. But the whole week is going to be warm except for Thursday, when it's going to be 83 and rainy. And then this weekend, they're looking for highs of 99 and 96 on Saturday and Sunday with sun. So if you like that hot weather, it's a great day for a picnic. Oh, we have so much to present to you today. It's hard to know where to go next. We came back from Netroots Nation. When was that? Yesterday? I feel like it was 6 months
ago. It's like part of me is still there.
Yeah, me too. We could talk about that. I mean, there's like a buzz that happens there. And I'm actually kind of interested in your thoughts, because I know you told me secretly off the air that there was, and I'm going to blow you out of the water, I'm going to blow it up for you now, that you went out to dinner. We all went to our separate ways and just hooked up with new communities while we were out there. And you said you went out to dinner, and at the dinner table there was that conversation about, do we work outside the system or do we work within the system? Now, having seen that Netroots Nation has both outsiders of the system and insiders of the system, plus what you just saw yesterday, which is outsiders, and I would argue that the media people, the large media conglomerations that were there, are insiders. What has that informed your thoughts about the state of where we are now?
Interesting question.
Thank
there
you.
Were a lot more insiders. There were a lot more insiders there than I thought, even though you warned me. Yeah, you did.
This isn't left form. This is right. Just to the right of left form.
Right of left form.
It's right of left form.
So, but it still showed me that even it showed me a lot more power that the progressive wing, even that progressive wing, is a larger block than I thought it was. So that was encouraging, because if you've got that kind of bulge to the left of the left, then I think that can support what's going on.
Now, one of the things I noticed when I was doing the interviews is that people would say, now, where's this going to? And I say, WBAI, it's Pacifica. We're also there on act.tv, because we did a lot of these interviews specifically for that. And they would say, well, they would kind of feel me out as to, like, do they have to give their professional speech, or can they really break it down. And I was like, listen, we are, you know, we straddle the line between radicals, Occupy Wall Street people, progressives, black radicals. We've got, we're not your average bunch of Joes watching on WBAI or either platform. And then they would kind of open up. So with, I'm going to play a clip from Egberto Willis, who is our host from our sister station in Houston, and we were talking about, is there going to be a race war? Do you have conversation? I mean, who talks like, who, where do you go for that conversation?
Around that table, around that table that night. I mean, all kinds of things like that were coming up. That's what the inside-outside game basically is.
And it's nice to have a place where you can actually have that conversation, which we're hoping to bring to this. These airwaves and video waves every day at 7 o'clock in the morning, which is what we do. So let's hear that clip from Egberto Willis.
You have the people, when they hear the idea of class warfare, it kind of brings up people in the streets with pitchforks, and the right is always using the terms race war. We're going to start a race war. Can we clear up the reality behind these terms they're using?
Let me tell you, first of all, we are not going to have a race war. They, you know, the plutocracy, those guys on top would like you to believe that that's what it's all about. I have a phrase that I use on Politics Done Right, my show, that I says, when we unite Appalachia, you know what Appalachia is?
The mountain people.
Right, and the ghettos, you know who I'm talking about?
Well, I live right near that.
Okay, and the barrios, you know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
When we get all of that together, you know what's going to happen? All these people that are that have the shoes on our neck, they're finally going to go away. That's a class warfare I'm talking about. A class warfare begins by us uniting. When I say uniting, I mean getting together and saying, hey, they've been playing us for all this time. Now that we are united, we can play them. And it's already starting. When you saw that that Elizabeth, somebody like Elizabeth Warren, go into West Virginia, and the people said, "Oh, I kind of like that." When Ocasio-Cortez went and spoke to that that coal miner, was like, "Oh, okay, that's what you're talking about." What we have to do, those of us that are working in the independent media, what we have to do is be solid with the message, not be sellouts. When we get all of that together, you know what's going to happen? All these people that are that have the shoes on our neck, they're finally going to go away. That's a class warfare I'm talking about. A class warfare begins by us uniting. When I say uniting, I mean getting together and saying, hey, they've been playing us for all this time. Now that we are united, we can play them. And it's already starting. When you saw that that Elizabeth, somebody like Elizabeth Warren, go into West Virginia, and the people said, oh, I kind of like that.
Offer you what used to be called a premium, but now it's just basically a gift. If you become a WBAI buddy, WBAI buddies are important because they give recurring. They are the base of the donation group, right? So if you're a buddy, you give your credit card information, and it takes off $5, $8, $15, $40, $75, $150, whatever you can afford to support your station here on WBAI. Monthly, right? It's your monthly contribution. It's like getting your New York Times, but without all the pro-war spin. So that's what we ask. We ask you to do that. And when we have that, when we understand who is pledging at that level, we can say, okay, this amount of money is promised to come in. We don't have to worry so much. There's always kind of this, you know, when you are listener-supported, you really are always hoping and that you'll be listener supported. We've been here for 65 years, but of course there's been ups and downs. And so we are looking to expand our base. And if you're new to WBAI, we don't take any corporate contributions. Zero. We are not NPR. We do not take money from the Koch brothers. We do not take money from oil and gas. We do not take money from pharma. We only accept money from you, who you then become a part of the station. You can vote. I think it's above $25, then you can vote in our elections. You know, this is really a people-powered radio station. So if you become a WBAI buddy in the name of this show, Waking Up, we will give you this gift today. And this is a book we offered earlier, and then people went crazy because they were mad, and then some people were really thrilled but didn't get in on it, so we decided to offer it again. So I'm pre-apologizing to the people who are angry, but hey, it's always great to read what anyone is saying so you can be informed. You don't have to necessarily agree, but Bill Ayers, we all know what happened with Bill Ayers and the Obama age. He became, you know, a persona smeared with...
Tarred with his past, you know, in an age when people were fighting hard to end militarism and the war in Vietnam, Bill Ayers and the Weather Underground took it to an extreme, but in their minds at that time, a necessary end. And then later on, he became an educator and has now written a book called Demand the Impossible, A Radical Manifesto.
I'm just glad no one holds, at some point you should not hold against people what happens to them, especially if they make a...
But you have to look at what was going on in that era. I mean, the violence that was being perpetrated around the world, and in their minds, and I'm not justifying it, they were setting off bombs in places where there was nobody, and they cleared everybody out because they were trying to give a taste of the own medicine. So anyway, that was a sign of the times.
Yeah.
But now, in an era defined by mass incarceration, endless war, economic crisis, catastrophic environmental destruction, and a political system offering more of the same, radical social transformation has never been more urgent. And he has basically a toolkit for that, and he's getting props from Angela Davis, Naomi Klein, Robin DJ Kelly, all who are raving about the book. And just to make it timely, I looked up Black Lives Matter, and he's got a section here about BLM and some of the other groups in Chicago who were part of the new youth movement that so many people had been disparaging. So even BLM is in here.
Yeah, so, and this book is our gift to you if you become a WBAI buddy today. It has to be date specific, so you have to do it today. I would suggest doing it before the end of the show.
Right now.
If you're driving and not available to do that, yeah, like right now is good. Throughout the rest of the day. And we have a limited number, obviously. I think we have like 15 or...
Oh, well,
we gave some before.
Now.
Yeah,
it's
we get
now.
That's right. Yeah. People got them last time, so maybe we have about half that. So if you want to get in on it now, become a WBAI buddy. In the name of waking up, that money goes to support the entire WBAI station, and we will appreciate it. The phone number. Have you been waiting?
You're like, yes.
My pen. Okay,
yes.
516-620-3602. 516-620-3602, or if you prefer your phone numbers in a deeper register,
516-620-3602.
If you don't like phones, you can text WBAI to 41444-41444. And the website is give2wbai.org. If you just want to give, if you've been moved to give and moved to shorten our upcoming fund drive starting on the 22nd, if you give now, that will shorten it up for us. I mean, I like raising money because we get to talk about the importance of independent media and the specific importance in this period in time. We're going to have Tom Hartman on later in the show to talk about that as well. But also I want to make sure that we have enough time in this 1 hour to bring you all the news that you need. And, you know, now we've got King, who is like on the ground reporting for us, which is really valuable, especially because, first of all, there are very few who are doing on the ground reporting of political and social movements. And WBAI is the voice that brings them to you. So get on that line, 516-620-3602. Give the number 2, WBAI.org. You can do that there too. The book is Demand the Impossible, a radical manifesto that you'll get basically at any level if you become a WBAI buddy this morning. It is already up to 76 degrees, going up to 90. There's a heat wave on the way for the entire country. Stay tuned for more. We'll take a musical break and be back with Professor Richard Wolff.
tales of Warren and Weiss, but you turn right over to the TV page. And I
interlude. We're kind of a high energy show here, and but Alana, bless her, looks for, as a good assistant producer does, looks for music that is tied in to the topics that we're discussing. And today we are again discussing what's happening at the border, and there are some references to a wall in that song. So I hope you enjoyed it. Joining us now, you know, is Professor Richard Wolff. Here on WBAI, we regularly talk about how the detention facilities where children go without soap, without toothpaste, is a moral catastrophe, and I would argue a stain on our collective conscience. While we hope that the images of children in cages will move everyone to action, the truth is that for corporations and executives who lead those corporations, profits are a stronger motivator than morality. Surprise, surprise. How can we get to the root of this system that makes money off the suffering of immigrant children? Professor Richard Wolff is back on Waking Up to talk about that. Professor Wolff, thanks for joining us.
Oh, glad to be here.
I have missed you. Where have you been?
Well, it's summertime. I take a little time off.
Yes, from you take a slight, you hang up your cape.
Yes, that's right. It's on a hook.
Well, no, you are doing such a huge service, and the enormous popularity of your show, which is here on WBAI on Economic Update, which is Fridays at 6:30 on WBAI, is a testament to, you know, how people are waking up, shall we say, to not overuse the name of our show here. Professor Wolff, can you talk about how it is that our economic system allows for companies to profit off the abuse that's happening specifically to the migrant adults and children in these detention facilities?
Well, you know, it's part of a long-standing system. It's, in a way, the ugliest part of it, but it is really not new. The whole phenomena of immigration has been an example of how an economic system that is set up like ours does this. So let me go back just a moment. When people are desperate, let me give you an example with the current situation. People may not know it, but the price of coffee, a pound of coffee beans at the plantation where the coffee is grown, dropped in the last few years from over $1.20 per pound to around 55 cents.
Why did that happen?
That happened largely because in Brazil, there was an enormous increase in the production of coffee. That's a desperate economy of its own. And they're trying to find a way to make a little bit more money. They produced a great deal of extra coffee, way beyond what the world market needed.
I'm trying to help by drinking more coffee, but
yeah, you may not have noticed the drop in prices because your local coffee shop hasn't.
Yeah, no, they haven't reflected those savings. They haven't passed the savings on to us, shall we say.
That's right. So there's your first example of how the economic system works. This was a wonderful profit boon for the coffee chains and so forth because they could pocket the lower price of what they paid.
Is there any evidence that they're paying their baristas more, that they're using some of them? Okay, just wondered.
There's evidence that they're doing nothing of the sort. They're keeping those extra pennies per pound just for their profits. So that's the first example. Here's the second one. When the price of coffee drops because of this, small coffee farmers, and there are lots of them, in places like Honduras and Costa Rica and Guatemala and El Salvador, those are wiped out. Those people have no income compared to what they need. They can't cover their costs. Their farms are lost. They begin the trek north to become immigrants, going to the United States for the same reason that...
That my family came here.
That's right, and mine too, and everybody else is in America.
Not mine.
Awful lot. That's right.
Yeah.
There's a different story for African American.
Yeah. But it's actually still connected. They just dragged you.
Yes, but that's right. It was the same.
You were doing fine. And
the same system that saw profits in bringing African slaves here and all the rest. Anyway, these farmers wanted to come to the United States for the same reason that that white people from Europe came to the United States. And the reality is that the Statue of Liberty notwithstanding, it is now profitable for at least Republicans and Mr. Trump to not let them in, to make it appear, which is disgusting in all the ways you've documented.
Yeah, you know,
to make it appear that they are the economic problem for working class Americans. Unspeakable. The number of undocumented immigrants in this country couldn't be more than 10, maybe 11 million people, if that. We are a population of 325 million people. To say that the economic difficulties and the political and cultural difficulties of the American working people, the majority, have to do with this tiny number of undocumented immigrants is a disgusting effort to scapegoat a group that is among the poorest of us.
Well, there's no hidden agenda anymore. Especially, I mean, everyone knows what Trump is, a white supremacist. He's an orange supremacist. Last month, Bank of America announced that it's going to stop lending to operators of private prisons and immigrant detention centers following a review of the bank's environmental, social, and governance board, and also from outside pressure of the users and people who are doing some of these actions to pull their investments away from places that do things like lend to private prisons. Is it possible under our current economic system to disincentivize companies from profiting off these detention facilities?
Sure. Drawing this kind of attention to them is a way of doing that. The problem is, if Bank America, and I'm not speaking specifically, I don't know the details there, but if Bank America doesn't lend directly to those companies, you can be sure that Bank America makes its money available to other banks who will do that, to intermediate lenders.
Oh, so it's like greenwashing, but brownwashing.
That's right. You cover your image for purposes of that. I'm not saying not to do it. It makes life more difficult. It makes extra costs for them. It's a small interference. But you have a system, whether it's slavery, whether it's the coffee business, whether it's investing in these detention centers. Capitalism looks for profits. Profits is the bottom line, as they proudly tell us. And if profit is your ultimate goal, then the morality along the way becomes, at best, a temporary nuisance. You cannot expect a system governed by money-making and profit to suddenly become moral. If you want the morality to govern, then you have to make that the bottom line. You have to have a different system that isn't driven by profits in the way that our system is.
But unfortunately, we don't have that right now, and kids are, like, dying in cages right now. What do you think is the quickest and most productive way we can disrupt this system that rewards this abuse in an economic fashion? Because it's so much, I don't know, it's so much more present and an emergency than, say, can we vote into Bernie Sanders and have incremental change? Is there any economic pressure we can put on, given the system as it is? And if your answer is no, that's fine, too, but, you know.
No. Look, there's two things that we can do. Number one, recognize that capitalism is full of its own internal problems and difficulties, and that those need to be exposed and those need to be worked on. We have in the United States, for example, as a result of our system, a level of inequality that takes us back to the 19th century, in some ways takes us back to ancient Pharaoh. We have a man, Jeffrey Bezos, who has $160 billion in wealth. This is ridiculous. Desperate needs around the country that we are not having met, so that a few people can have 27 palaces and 18 jets and all the rest of it. This is a sign of a system that is not working for most people. And if we say that, and if we teach that, and if we spread that understanding, you will begin to see very creative ways that people have of saying, we won't tolerate this anymore. By the way, that's why today's front page is covered by Mr. Trump's combination of anti-socialism, racism, white supremacy. He needs to mix those together. His job is to serve to keep this system going, whether it's cutting the taxes in 2017 or attacking the four women congresspersons that he's now decided to make into a lump. His senator sidekick, Lindsey Graham, joins in. They're going to call these people every name they can. Their job is to make people angry at anything other than the capitalist system, because they recognize, too, that that system is now very vulnerable because of how it has treated people. So it becomes very urgent to rerun the old split white from black, split liberal from socialist, and all the rest, the standard toolbox of keeping a system going whose own internal problems are turning people into challengers of that system. And whether you see it in AOC or Bernie or Elizabeth Warren or any of the others, these are the signs of a growing movement that is frightening them, which is why they have to put the kind of extremist like Trump in there, and why all of the elite that support him are so terribly silent as he does his job.
Aren't they? We're speaking with Professor Richard Wolff, Marxian economist and professor of economics emeritus at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. He's the host of Economic Update with Richard Wolff on WBAI right here on our station Fridays at 6:30 p.m., which is syndicated on over 70 other stations nationwide, but we want you to listen here. Yay! Or you can watch it on YouTube. He has his own channel if you want to see him physically. Professor Wolff, what's coming up this week on the show?
Well, we're going to be doing a number of interesting things. We had a remarkable program we just finished producing talking about the implications of that remarkable women's U.S. soccer team. Because, you know, that's not just a sporting event that captured people's attention. The demand of those women to get equal pay for the work they do, the way they showed the discrimination against women athletes in favor of men athletes in the same sport, really captured an awful lot of people's imagination. And it reminds everyone, again, that this is an economic system that systematically discriminates against people on basis of color, on basis of gender, in ways that has no justification in any moral or ethical universe that I'm familiar with.
I hope we can go back to a moral and ethical universe. Is that possible?
Remind people that one could organize one's life around that kind of thing, but what we've done is subordinated ethical and moral considerations to making money, so that for many people they've lost the notion that there's a difference.
Professor Wolff, thank you so much for joining us on the program. We look forward to your bi-weekly visits here, and we will talk to you again. Thanks.
Okie doke, thank you.
You're listening to Waking Up with Julianna Forlano and King Downing here in the studio, coming to you live from WBAI 99.5 FM, all over New York City, Jersey, Long Island, all the way up to Connecticut, hello Pennsylvania, and apparently now we have listeners all over the country. So if you're new and you like this kind of talk, please donate to WBAI at 516-620-3602, 516-620-3602, and you will become, if you become a WBAI buddy in the name of this show, today you will get the book, Demand the Impossible, A Radical Manifesto by Bill Ayers, yes, the one and only. We already did our apologizing and defending at the beginning of this show, so you can rewind if you want that. But hey, I think it's a good read, and it's very, very timely. Also, by the way, just to piggyback on Professor Wolff's point, when we were at Netroots this week, I interviewed an immigration lawyer and hope to bring you that piece or full interview that I was able to do there. I had to interview four or five people about immigration to get this answer that I wanted. What do we do if we... when we're at the camps saying we want the kids out, what do we do? What do we do? We just open the door and let them go home? What happens? And people didn't really know, except this one guest said these, and this was the first time I heard this in the media was on Democracy Now! Yesterday, and I had just heard it the weekend before. The kids all have family members. they can just go. It's not like you have to, most of them, almost, I think she said 90% of the kids have family members that either the kids themselves know the number, the phone number, know the family members, know where they need to go. Right here in the United States, they could be let out at any minute. So this idea of freeing the camps is not going to require some big resettlement effort. The kids have families that they can go to where they could be sleeping in a bed and brushing their teeth. And, you know, if your only concern, if you're a vile person listening to our show and your only concern is how this is going to affect the economy, well, they'll be buying toothpaste on their own, and therefore that stimulates the economy, okay? So just, I think that's a really important point to note. It's not going to take a giant effort. We just have to let them go and send them home and use the money that we're using to cage them to put them, you know, safely in travel. They can get themselves home. By the way, you may have heard me coughing earlier. We don't have a cough button on this side of the desk. So if you don't like that, we ask you to give to WBAI. We're building out our new studio. I believe there's going to be a cough button on that side. 516-620-3602. So you don't have to hear me doing my spit takes in the morning.
And you can designate cough button in your donation.
Oh, man. I really like talking to Professor Wolff. Okay, so we weren't able to get our normal, what we've been doing, in case you haven't been listening, in case you're just joining us and just becoming familiar with our show, we have at WBAI a strip of shows at 5 p.m. that are all for local news, and Revolutions Per Minute is on tonight. Jack couldn't be with us this week, but they're going to be talking today about the Queer Liberation March and how the New York City Democratic Socialists of America Queer Caucus organized 45,000 people into an anti-capitalist formation on Pride Day as part of this Reclaim Pride Coalition. It's really exciting. It's going to be on at 5 p.m. on Revolutions Per Minute. If you can't join at that time, you can go to WBAI.org and hear that. And thank you, Jack, for sending in that report. Also happening, don't forget that New Jersey's rally for the 100% renewable energy that has been so long awaited in that state. The draft of the Energy Master Plan has just been released. The document is supposed to be the blueprint to get New Jersey to a 100% clean energy, you know, by 2050. As a clean energy state, 100% we're talking, not 50, not 20. This is an aggressive goal, and, you know, it should be for New Jersey because it's a low-lying state. If they're sure, they're going to lose a lot of money if the shoreline goes, and they are responsible for refining a lot of the fossil fuels that we're seeing going out from our country today. So there's a lot of work. You know, there's a lot of good things that can come from having New Jersey be 100% clean energy. The first public hearing on this draft energy master plan is going to be tomorrow. So if you're not able to make it to the Eric Garner one in the afternoon, you can go Wednesday at 9:30 a.m. to 137 West State Street in Trenton. 137 West State Street in Trenton. Governor Murphy and his Board of Public Utilities need to hear activists loud and clear. So they are calling for a strong presence, and they need a plan to achieve 100% renewables in New Jersey, and we need it right now. And not just New Jersey needs it, but the whole world needs it. So if you're able to get there by 9:30 or around 9:30, that would be super duper helpful. And please give us a call and let us know how it went. I'm really excited about the resurgence of protest movement in our country and the fact that it's actually having an effect. You know, going back to the first part of our show where the Black Lives Matter people are actually getting a meeting for Garner's family. We have so much more to talk about. In our program today, I was able to have a conversation with a presidential candidate, almost three presidential candidates. We had done interviews in 10-minute segments at Netroots for 8 hours in a row, and by the time the presidential candidates forum came about, we were pretty much toasted. So I did get to speak to Governor Inslee. Do you know he's the governor of Washington State? He's the one who is running on climate change. He's the one I criticized after the debate because he didn't tie everything to climate change. If he's the climate change guy, when they're asking him about immigration, he needs to tie it to climate change. He's saying climate change is the biggest problem we have, the biggest existential threat to all of us. So you need to tie all that in. Who is not telling him this? Not you, right, kid?
It's not me.
We need somebody to tell him this. So I did, and we're going to play the interview. Just in my own way, tried to encourage him to tie everything to climate change, since that is his issue. That's the platform he's running on. I heard him interviewed by a number of people on Media Row, and they all asked him about different things. I guess maybe they're just like, oh, he must be good on climate change. Let's see how he is on policing. And, you know, talking about the fact that if it's a fight for scarce resources and it's police against people who are living with, you know, in scarcity, that does have to do with climate change. You know, tie the, maybe it's far field, but I think it all has to do with us fighting for resources, including racism, how it's been incited, so that we can fight with each other for resources instead of doing what Alberto says, which is get together and pitchfork the 1%. Here's Governor Inslee live from NetRoots.
Hi, Governor Inslee. Thank you so much for bringing climate change to the forefront of this debate. Can you talk about how you can connect climate change to all the different things that people are asking you about, immigration, mass incarceration? It seems like climate change has to do with everything, and I really want to hear your thoughts about that.
Well, this is a global problem in two ways. It's global, meaning the whole Earth, but it's global because it touches all of the other things that's important in our lives. It touches our economy because it's devastating our economy right now. The agricultural economy in the West has been just creamed because of the floods. It touches our ability to grow jobs, because when we grow clean energy jobs, we can all get good work. It touches our health care. Look, people are now getting Lyme disease in New Hampshire where they did not. It's touching our national security issue. The Pentagon, CIA, have their hairs on fire about the mass migrations that are going to create political instability and warfare. So it touches so many things in our lives. And so that's a reason that I think we can all be united in saying that Donald Trump is wrong. Wind turbines do not cause cancer, they cause jobs. This is not a hoax, it is a scientific reality. And I'm the candidate who is saying this, and I'm the only candidate saying this.
How are we going to take on the fossil fuel industry, which is so entrenched in our political process right now?
We're going to elect a president, namely myself,
yes,
who has stood up to the fossil fuel industry, who said we have to deny them the $20 billion of subsidies they have, that have to deny them the ability to continue to pollute and try to lock us into decades of fossil fuel pollution, and try to help Americans get jobs in the clean energy economy. That's a winning proposition, and it is the best way to beat Donald Trump, because this is his weakest position. He's demonstrated that by trying to say he's an environmentalist. What a joke.
Oh, that was a joke.
What a joke.
Well, from the bottom of my heart and from my children, I really thank you for doing this, because I've been waiting for years for climate change to be on top of things. I will. We will.
Send in a buck so I can stay on the climate.
Oh, yeah, the buck. He needs a buck. Send in a buck.
You know, the financing of his campaign, if he's taking major donors, if he's not, if he's taking, like, if he's Cory Bookering it, where he's like, I used to be beholden to pharma, but now I'm not taking their money. So I guess we'll see. Cory Booker was not there. Elizabeth Warren was there. She gave an amazing speech. She actually, someone tried to shout her down about immigration and tying her to the Obama era immigration policy, which she had nothing to do with. So I'm starting to wonder, like, who's coming to shout at this thing now? You may remember NetRoots Nation has a history of disrupting presidential candidates when Bernie Sanders was there. Black Lives Matter protesters jumped in front of the stage, and he gave them the mic, and then it was kind of this whole thing that wound up giving the impression that he wasn't good on certain issues, and he did have to evolve, and he did bring them into the campaign. He had to kind of get up to speed on today's issues with the community, as opposed to the issues that he was fighting for when he was, you know, marching with the civil rights movement and all of those things that everybody knows about. We almost had Elizabeth Warren. We almost had her. We were exhausted, and we chased her. Her people gave us a green light at the very last moment, but we weren't able to catch her. And then we had the opportunity to interview Julian Castro, which was amazing. And we were like, oh, this is great. But we had already packed everything up and, like, put it back away in the hotel room, so it just wouldn't have worked out. But we did get all the contact information from the comms people, and I would like to make WBAI a place where people expect to be interviewed. even in a presidential election. And I think that that is happening. We actually, King was able to speak with or even get up close to both Ayanna.
Ilan.
Thank you. No, that's not the one I was going to say.
Oh,
no,
it was Ayanna Pressley. Okay.
Ayanna Pressley. Okay. Sorry. Okay. I have them both in front of me in their minds. And so how wonderful is that? We're not able to play it because we're up against the end of our show here today. But tomorrow we will be able to play those things. And thank you for listening. And I am looking forward to having our listener call-in line open one of these days. We just have so much to present to you from everything that is going on and everything we've been able to do from going to that conference. Stay cool. It's going to be hot out there. Again, thanks for listening. Don't forget to become a WBAI buddy at 516-620-3602. We are live streaming this show on YouTube at act.tv right now and on Twitch, also under act.tv's banner. Thank them for their help and assistance in getting our faces out there. Pretty soon we'll be on the WBAI Facebook page with our faces as well. Thank you, King, for being here with me.
Thank you.
All right, we'll see you tomorrow.
One of WBAI's most listened to program hosts, Dr. Gary Null, is doing another fundraiser for WBAI Radio. He will premiere his new film, Deadly Deception.
And this is a hard, hard-hitting documentary. And everyone who's interested in the truth about the deep state and vaccines and big pharma and the corruption of the CDC, it's all documented.
And Gary will be in conversation with another WBAI host, Leonard Lopate.
And I said, I'll only speak with Leonard if he asks me hard questions. I don't like softball questions. Throw the fast.